First of all, allow me to thank you, Professor Tim Lindsay, for a very nice and long introduction. I sometimes don't feel I deserve that. My special thanks also goes to Dean Carolyn Evans for bringing me back to this beautiful law school and beautiful city. I was telling Dean Evans that I was falling in love with the city a long time ago. And it is always nice to be back here. I would like to talk about new Indonesia. With the new governments, new hope, and new challenge. One of the challenges is to invent Indonesia to become a state based on rule of law, or in Bahasa Indonesia, known as negara hukum. The Indonesian Constitution was adopted on 18 August 1945, one day after Indonesia proclaimed independence and declared Indonesia to be a state based on law, or what is termed in the Indonesian language, negara hukum, or rechtsstaat in Dutch, usually translated in English as rule of law or state based on rule of law. It is a sad truth that negara hukum has never actually existed in Indonesia, even though every constitution we have had has provided that the state is based on law, not merely power. On the surface, there has never been any disagreement with this principle. But below the surface, intense ideological struggle has always taken place between those seeking to implement the rule of law and the many who oppose it. It is not surprising that the Constitution has long been interpreted differently, depending on who is making the interpretations. President Soekarno, a strong and charismatic leader, sought to contain the struggle between the supporters of the negara hukum and its opponents, but ultimately failed. In doing so, he subjected negara hukum to what he termed the unfinished revolution, the subordinating the law to the revolution. President Soeharto, on the other hand, considered stability and order essential to the existence of the state and prioritized that over rule of law. Under his authoritarian governments from 1965 to 1998, the 1945 Constitution was treated as a sacred document, not to be amended or replaced, and no criticism of it or its destructive interpretation and implementation by the state was tolerated. When Suharto's government finally collapsed in 1998, paralyzed by a deep economic crisis, a new government came to power. Habibie, who was Suharto's vice president, constitutionally became the new president. Habibie initiated a series of bold policies to restore the confidence of the people, build a new and more transparent and accountable system, restore democracy and freedom of press, and revive negara hukum. Habibie was ousted in 1999, but in his 1 year as president, he managed to promulgate various laws and regulations that paved the way for a new Indonesia where democracy, human rights, rule of law, regional autonomy, and the eradication of corruption were officially adopted as the agenda for the future. Habibie contributed greatly to changing the authoritarian state to a more open and democratic state. Laws enacting during Habibie's governments that related to the revival of negara hukum laid the foundations for the reinstallations of negara hukum, or rather its recrowning. There were around 50 pieces of legislation promulgated in the dramatic period between May 1998 till October 1999. And among those, there are a few that may be considered central to reviving and strengthening the notion of negara hukum, such as the amendment of the law on judicial powers, the law on corruption eradications, the law on arbitration and alternative dispute resolution, the law on clean government free from corruption, collusion and nepotism, and the law on the revocations of subversive acts and amendment to the criminal code with regard to crimes against the state. In addition, important pieces of legislation were passed concerning ratifications of certain international human rights instruments, such as the Convention Against Torture, Cruel, Inhuman, and Degrading Treatment, the Convention on Forced Labor, and the Convention Concerning Discrimination in Respect of Employment and Occupations, ILO Convention. Although reform was not complete, the mere fact of the promulgations of these important laws must be considered a huge achievement, given that the government itself was fragile and unstable and under constant political pressures. There have now been more than 300 pieces of legislation enacted by Parliament, including a substantial number relating to legal institutions, substance and enforcement. Several important legal institutions like the Constitutional Court, Judicial Commission, Ombudsman, Corruption Eradication Commission, and few others have been established. Likewise, legal agencies such as the judiciary, the police, and the prosecution's service have been forced to improve their organizational and professional capability to better meet the needs of a system based on rule of law. Under Suharto's governments, economic development placed Suharto at the center of all power. After 1998, however, the law was treated as supreme, at least in theory. Everybody must be treated equally, and no one is above the law. Legal compliance, therefore, is now obligatory for every action and transaction, be it by governments or the business community. The president and all high-ranking government officials pledge to uphold the rule of law, guarantee the independence of the judiciary, not interfere in legal proceedings, and support legal institutions in their roles as law enforcers. All parties and political actors claim to have a commitment to good governance. True negara hukum, however, require more than this. There are other elements that must be present. As the founding Chief Justice of Constitutional Court, Jimli As-Siddiqui, has stated, there must be one, an institutional element, two, an instrumental element, and three, subjective and cultural elements. The three elements include lawmaking, law administering, and law adjudicating. The law adjudicating element has been referred to as law enforcement in the narrow sense, namely law enforcement by the police, prosecutors, advocates, and judges. But aside from that, one must not forget about the socialization of law and legal education, and law information management as supporting elements. Since Reformasi began in 1998, thousands of laws and regulations have been introduced at central and regional levels, and a large range of international instruments have also been ratified. Additionally, around 200 state auxiliary agencies have been established to provide checks and balances and open more space for people participation. In addition to those already mentioned, these new agencies include the Election Commission, the Financial Transaction Reporting and Analysis Centers, the Witness and Victim Protection Agencies that deals with whistleblowers, the Press Council, the Broadcasting Commission, the National Human Rights Commission, and many others. Unfortunately, there have not been sufficient budget increase in support of the new law enforcement agencies. There is in fact little more than 10% of the state budget allocated to cover all of the Supreme Court, the Ministry of Law and Human Rights, the Attorney General's, the Constitutional Court, the Judicial Commission, and the Corruption Eradication Commission combined. In fact, rather than negara hukum being strengthened, it seems to have begun to weaken in recent years. Despite all the new laws and agencies, the law has not functioned as it should. There have been so many irregularities, overlaps, and conflicts between laws and regulations, vertically and horizontally. There have ever been unhealthy rivalries between law agencies. Human resources have also not been adequately professionalized due to inadequate recruitment and poor training programs. The public are well aware of these shortcomings, as they are the ones who suffer the most from them. So it was not surprising that during the recent Indonesian election campaign, both legislative and presidential, the promise to recrown negara hukum was frequently reiterated. But promises are one thing, implementation is quite another. Whether the new government succeeds in recrowning negara hukum depends on whether it genuinely considers it as a priority. There are a number of programs could help create a reasonably solid foundation for a new negara hukum. I will now describe some of the most important of this. One is independent and impartial judiciary. One basic principle of negara hukum is an independent and impartial judiciary that enables formal and substantial legality and recognition and protection of fundamental human rights. The Rule of Law Index, published by the Indonesian Legal Roundtables, lists 5 principles and indicators of negara hukum. Namely, 1, a government based on law, 2, independent judiciary, 3, recognition and protection of human rights, 4, independent judiciary, 4, access to justice, and 5, transparent and clear legislations. When Reformasi began in 1998, demands that an independent judiciary be restored were loudly voiced by various elements of society, including intellectuals, professionals, business communities, and political parties, and this had significant political impact. Since 1998, constitutional and legislative changes have created a relatively strong judicial authority with guaranteed independence and impartiality. Under Soeharto's regime, the judicial authority was managed and tightly controlled by both the executive and the Supreme Court, making independence and impartiality unattainable. However, after amendment of the 1945 Constitution, the judicial authority was separated from the executive. The Supreme Court is now the only institution managing the judiciary. Constitutionally, judicial authorities have all the power needed to uphold the law and do justice without any interference from the governments, business communities, political parties, militaries, or any other groups. The constitutional power vested in the judiciary has become a source of independence and impartiality. Law in the books and law in actions are, however, two entirely different things. While independence and impartiality in day-to-day practice is guaranteed by the constitutions, the absence of such independence and impartiality is very easy to find. There have been blatant violations of justice in so many police and prosecutorial investigations, in court proceedings, and in a wide range of executive actions since the amendment of the constitutions. Most of this have been committed against poor and marginalized people. It is no surprise, therefore, to hear people argue that the law seems to be effective against the poor, but paralyzed against the rich. Many perceive the legal apparatus, including the judiciary, as having become an instrument of those who have the means to buy its support. Justice for all as a principle has no bearing at all. The Rule of Law Index found that most of people believe that Indonesian judges are not free from bribery or undue interference, be it from governments, political parties, and business people. In addition, the selection and appointment of judges seems to still be tainted by corruption, collusion, and nepotism, while their remuneration and facilities are evidently far from adequate. It is not uncommon, therefore, to read reports of this miscarriage of justice in verdicts rendered by courts at all levels. And it is not only the poor and the marginalized who are the victims. Many others who are not well connected, including companies, have also fallen victim to apparently arbitrary decision by the judiciary. It is not surprising, therefore, to see skepticism growing in many circles, and society at large is concerned once again about the deterioration of the judiciary. This is not to say that there have been no improvements in strengthening the independence and impartiality of the judiciary. Obviously, there have been a series of actions taken to reform the judiciary at all levels, led by the Supreme Court and Judicial Commission. The Supreme Court, for example, has made all its decisions accessible through a designated website, and many district courts have installed their own websites where all information regarding ongoing cases and decisions can be accessed. Additionally, the selection of judges has been more transparent, involving the well-regarded Judicial Commission. Improvements have also been made in terms of training, remuneration, facilities, and supervision. With the free press closely watching the judiciary, one would think that its independence and impartiality should not be longer an issue. Unfortunately, all these improvements have not significantly changed the perception of the public of the judiciary. It is still viewed as the weakest point in our constitutional architectures. This is not to say that there have been no enlightened court decisions produced, but there are many that affront the popular sense of justice. Let us not forget that there have been many judges who have been caught red-handed, receiving bribes to deliver judgment favorable to the bribers. The arrest of the Chief Justice of the Constitutional Court, Akil Mohtar, by the Corruption Eradication Commission for receiving bribes from various parties who were themselves either plaintiffs or defendants was just the tip of the iceberg. This deterioration of the judiciary must be stopped. If democracy and economic development is to succeed, the paramount role of independent and impartial judiciary must be secured. Sustainability of democracy and economic development depends a great deal on a well-functioning, independent, and impartial judiciary. The strengthening of the judiciary and other law enforcement agencies must therefore be one of the highest priority for any Indonesian governments. Let me turn to the second agenda, corruption eradication. Corruption is not a new phenomenon. It is as old as human civilizations and can be found in almost every country in the world. But there are countries that are relatively free from corruption, and others where corruption is systemic, endemic, and widespread. Transparency International, an international NGO specializing in combating corruption, releases its annual survey with what it termed its Corruption Perception Index. According to the latest survey, Indonesia's position remains close to the bottom, meaning that it is still seen as one of the world's most corrupt countries. Relying on scores ranging from 0 to 100, where 0 is considered free from corruption and 100 the most corrupt, Indonesia Corruption Perception Index was 32 in 2013. In 2012, Indonesia's Corruption Perception Index was also 32. This means that in the last 2 years, corruption persists and not much progress has been made on its eradication. Realizing that corruption is not new and is still prevalent in so many countries, one has to recognize the systemic efforts to fight corruption are imperative. Frank Vogel, who spent many years with Transparency International, has written that all governments are vulnerable to corruption, and no government can claim that it does not harbor officials who abuse their office for personal gain. While it is almost certainly true that corruption in government will never be ended, it is equally true that much can be done to reduce its prevalence. Corruption is not a simple thing. It is a result of political, social, and economic issues that interact with one another. There's room to abuse power for personal gain, and in many instances, those opportunities have been provided by inadequacy of laws and regulations, or what's called lex imperfecta. This is because almost every regulation passed in Indonesia is the product of political compromises or deals, and it is therefore no surprise that there are many loopholes encountered. They are the price of compromise and transactional politics. Historically, it is part of the endless political process and can only be minimized once democracy is matured and rule of law is observed. Distinguished audience, interestingly, Indonesia has a relatively complete set of laws and regulations dealing with corruption eradication, such as laws on anti-corruption, money laundering, protection of whistleblowers, the Judicial Commission, and public information, for instance. In addition, ratification of the UN Convention Against Corruption has also been concluded. In terms of laws and regulation, it is fair to say that Indonesia has more than sufficient to deal with corrupt behavior at all levels, be it petty or grand corruption. To what extent the laws and regulations are implemented remains, however, to be seen. This is the real challenge. From an institutional point of view, the legal institutions necessary to combat corruption are also already in place. They include the Corruption Eradication Commissions, the State Audit Agency, the Financial and Development Audit Body, the Financial Transaction Reports and Analysis, that deals with money laundering, the judicial commissions, and the witness and victim protection agencies that deal with whistleblowers and justice collaborators. These agencies complement the works of traditional legal apparatus, like the police and prosecution service, in combating corruption as an extraordinary crime. They were set up in order to convince the public that combating corruption is a high priority, because that is clearly what they demand of their rulers. The new governments of Jokowi will officially assume powers on October 20th, 2014, a week from now probably, or 2 weeks from now. Throughout his campaign, Jokowi reiterated his strong commitment to fight corruption. His vision, mission, and action program listed no less than 42 initiatives for strengthening the negara hukum, and among them, at least 8 initiatives dealing with corruption eradication. This includes creating a fear of corruption culture, providing public service free from corruption through transparent information technology, promulgating supportive anti-corruption laws and regulations, strengthening the independence of the KPK, or Corruption Eradication Commissions, promoting working synergy between police, prosecutors, and the KPK, focusing on corruption in law enforcement agencies, politics, customs, tax, and mining, preventing corruption through implementation of national integrity system, and encouraging public participation and mass media to monitor the handling of corruption cases. Prior to the presidential election, the KPK, or Corruption Eradication Commission, published a book recommending 8 action agenda items for the new governments in combating corruption. These recommendations were formulated on the basis of its experience in going after corrupt officials and politicians since 2004. And they assume that corruption is endemic, systemic, and widespread. The 8 action agenda items are bureaucratic and administrative reform, management of mineral resources and revenues, food sovereignty, infrastructure improvement, strengthening of law enforcement agencies, support for education, focusing on integrity, improvement of political party institutions, and social welfare betterment. Needless to say, in these 4 sectors, corruption seems prevalent and corrosive, and is unfortunately still an integral element in the governance structures of the country. It is perhaps inappropriate to conclude that not much has been done to advance corruption eradication. Given 402 corrupt officials and politicians have been convicted in the last 10 years by the KPK. There have been also hundreds of corrupt individuals sent to prisons by the police and prosecutors. But corruption still persists. Data from the Corruption Perception Index of 2013 shows that corruption ranking of Indonesia 114 is only slightly better than Vietnam 116, Bangladesh 136, Nigeria 144, Myanmar 157, Zimbabwe 157, and Cambodia 160. For the record, the number of countries surveyed by Transparency International in 2013 is 175. Therefore, a ranking of 114 out of 175 countries is far indeed from satisfactory. From this perspective, corruption eradication in Indonesia has not had much impact. Despite all the arrests and conviction of recent years and all the controversy, they have spiraled. The pace of the anti-corruption fight must be accelerated. Political will is a must for which the involvement of all stakeholders is required. Jokowi's new government must attempt to combine powerful forces of robust civil society organizations, civil society organizations, promulgate a set of national and international anti-corruption laws, and exploit the rapid development of new information and media technologies, in addition to raising support from philanthropic foundations and academic researchers. The new government has only one option, and that is to continue combating corruption in order to provide justice to the people. Former UN Secretary General Kofi Annan was right when he said that corruption is an insidious plague that has a wide range of corrosive effects on societies. It undermines democracy and the rule of law, leads to violation of human rights, distort markets, erodes the quality of life, and allows organized crime, terrorism, and other threats to human security to flourish. Enforcement of anti-corruption policies will, however, require the right man in the right place. Someone with a proven track record on anti-corruption. Someone with courage and determinations. Getting its senior law enforcement appointments right at the start will therefore be of vital importance to the success of Jokowi administrations. Now let me turn to the third item's agenda of Jokowi with regard to investment policies. The new government has indicated it would like high economic growth of 7% per annum. This sounds too optimistic, given the global economy has still not yet fully recovered from series of crises in various parts of the world. Luckily, Indonesia economy managed to maintain a modest growth around 5% per annum despite the crisis, due to significant domestic consumption and earnings from the export of oil and gas, mineral resources, and manufacturing goods. There has therefore been a steady increase in the size of the middle class with substantial capacity to support the economy, in addition to new investment from both domestic and foreign companies. According to the World Bank, the per capita income of Indonesia has grown steadily in recent years. 2,272 in 2009, $2,947 in 2010, $3,470 in 2011, and $3,551 in 2012. Unfortunately, however, economic growth of 5% is not sufficient to create the job opportunities necessary to meet the demand of the large numbers of unemployed or underemployed. The result is poverty, created by a widening income gap between the rich, the new rich, the so-called middle class, and the poor, as well as the near poor. Joko Widodo, or Jokowi, therefore wants 7% economic growth in order to create 3 million jobs per year. The Association of Indonesia's Employers, APINDO, has argued, however, that to be able to create 3 million jobs per year, at least 8% economic growth per year is necessary. To what extent this is possible remains to be seen, but it is highly unlikely that 8% can be achieved. The global economy is still sluggish an unexpected downturn cannot be dismissed. Political tension with unintended consequences may also cause slowdown, not to mention other forms of regional or national crisis. In order to meet the basic needs of the people and provide services to them, it is understood that economic development must be directed to the fulfillment of food and energy self-sufficiency, the expansion of basic infrastructures, and the socially responsible exploitation of all resources onshore and offshore. It is the primary obligation of government to eradicate poverty gradually, and for this reasons, a flow of investment, domestic and foreign, small, medium, and large, must be encouraged by making available all the incentives that can possibly be offered. At the moment, Indonesia is not considered a favorable investment destination due to the many and various disincentives consciously or unconsciously placed in the ways of investors. Emerging economic nationalism and legal uncertainty have been regarded as the main hurdles of investment, especially for new incoming investors. Other countries in ASEAN, for instance, offer more incentives and guaranteed long-term security of investment and are therefore becoming more competitive. The challenge for our new government is to create a better and conducive investment climate in order to convince investors to think again about Indonesia, which for a period under Soeharto was once seen as a paradise for investors. Admittedly, this will require not only strong determinations, but also an ability to reconcile the need for to strengthen small and medium-sized businesses on one hand, while facilitating big business on the others. A new and growing democracy demands an inclusive economic policy. Legal certainty is central to investment. However, and this is the weakest point, one of the biggest problems is overlapping and conflicting laws and regulation at the vertical, national, and horizontal level. As we all know, there is a hierarchy of laws and regulation that includes the constitutions, statutes, government regulation, presidential decree, ministerial regulations, and regional or municipal regulations, in which no conflict may arise between the lower rank and higher rank laws. If there's a conflict, then the inferior regulation must be revoked, and that can be done through judicial review to either the Supreme Court or the Constitutional Court, depending on the type of laws in question. At the horizontal or local levels, conflicts can be found between many laws and regulations in fields like forestry and agriculture, or industry and foreign investment, among others. These conflicts must be resolved. To not do so will certainly discourage investment, as it will create a lot of hurdles and unjustifiable costs. Likewise, all laws and regulations that overlap must be dealt with in the sense that the overlaps must be resolved. There should not be overlapping laws and regulations to confuse those considering investing. Harmonization and synchronization of laws and regulations must be a priority of the new government if it is to provide a better and conducive investment climate. In the next 5 years, a special task force should be commissioned to identify all laws and regulations that overlaps or are in conflict with one another. If the policy is to attract more investment, it is imperative that streamlined and simplified investment procedures be in place. A plan to introduce e-commerce, e-tenders, e-transaction, e-procurement, for instance, would require transparent and clear laws and regulations. Only by doing all these things can a better and conducive investment climate can be built, and Indonesia can become competitive again. Aside from streamlining and simplifying laws and regulations, investment incentives must be offered through various laws and regulations. Tax holidays, land ownership, profit remittance, ease of investment, less stringent negative lists of investment, increased equity foreign participation, and security of long-term investment are among the things that need to be regulated. And security of long-term investment are among the things that need to be regulated in such a way as not to discourage foreign investment from staying and, if possible, expanding their business ventures. Those who invest in the eastern part of Indonesia should be offered additional incentives from regional municipalities to act as pioneers in transforming the local economy. And of course, all courtesies afforded to foreign investment must also be available to domestic investors partnering with foreign investors, with the objective of combining resources in order to be globally competitive. One problem that remains troublesome is the status of existing business contracts. Indonesia's civil code stipulates that a contract is binding upon the parties as law. But lately, too many contracts have been changed unilaterally or through investment regulations or executive decision. The argument put forward by government in these cases is that the insertion of new provisions is allowed where mandated by laws or regulation, especially if it relates to natural resources, which according to Article 33 of the 1945 Constitution are considered national wealth that must be fully used for the welfare of the people. This may be a valid reason, but it is clear that any amendment to any existing contract must be mutually agreed by the parties concerned. I'm speaking as a practicing lawyer now. Attempts to change, revise, or modify contracts unilaterally is similar to a breach of contract and may be brought before courts or arbitrations for resolution. The point is not that there's no legal resolution available, but that disrespect of the sanctity of contract is a serious threat to investment security, especially for international corporations. And Jokowi's new government must therefore commit itself to respect the sanctity of contracts. Another problem that needs mentioning is the phenomenon of criminalization of business or administrative disputes. In recent years, there have been a number of business and administrative cases investigated and tried as criminal offenses, such as the Chevron, Merpati, and IM2 cases, among others. I'm now representing Coca-Cola because they are also being criminalized by the prosecutors. There are alarming signals that criminalization of business and administrative disputes is continuing, with both the police and prosecutors investigating several large companies. It is not an overstatement to say that a feeling of uncertainty now hovers over the business community. In turn, plans to expand businesses have been postponed until business leaders feel that there's assurance from the governments that they will not be criminalized for their business activities unless there's a prima facie evidence that the criminal offense has in fact been committed. In some cases, there's a fine line between civil and criminal matters. But most of the time, civil and criminal matters can easily be distinguished. The new governments must do its utmost not to cause additional pain and uncertainty to the business community. In addition, the problem of enforcement of court or arbitration awards needs to be underlined, as the majority of these are not enforced. Legally, the courts should respect binding court decision or arbitration awards, but they seem reluctant to do so, even though there is no proper reason for this unenforcement. Opposition and improper influence by law practice is one reason for this reluctance. And there's also ambiguity on the part of the governments. And this is another factor that has led Indonesia to be perceived as an unfriendly country by the international investor community. These are just some of the legal hurdles faced by the business community, and needless to say that the new government must urgently do something to address them if investment is to be welcome and protected. The target of 7% economic growth to create 3 million jobs opportunities per year, alleviate poverty, and be globally competitive will require a firm commitment to transform Indonesia into a legally safe and attractive place for investment. It is true that economically, it will not be easy to meet the target of 7% economic growth. Indonesia is competing with other emerging economies, many of which are ahead in number of respects. But since the election, there's now a new momentum in Indonesia, a strong desire to move forward to build the country anew. And in some ways, it resembles the enthusiasm for change that dominated the brief period of Habibie's rule with all the hopes that entailed. Finally, I'm coming to the closing of my papers. Certainly, Jokowi's new government will have a golden opportunity in its first year with all the endorsement it needs. And the people will be willing to accept the costs necessary to pave the way for renewed reform. One of the institutions essential to guaranteeing such progress is the existence of negara hukum, which has long been neglected. Only by recrowning negara hukum will we be able to guarantee the sustainability of economic growth as promised. This is the single biggest challenge for Indonesia's incoming administrations. I think I should stop here. Thank you.
You know, and I'm a lawyer from Sydney, so I'm congenitally unable to keep my question short and sweet, but I'll do my best in the light of what you've just said, but having the benefit now of the last couple of weeks of extraordinary mischief being made by the Prabowo forces within the Indonesian Parliament, isn't there a very real challenge for Jokowi if he tries to embark upon these economic reforms that Prabowo will be, you know, as the newly reinvented economic nationalist, be able to play a very ugly populist campaign against any attempt to liberalise the economy and undermine the economy that way?
Well, it is true that emerging economic nationalism is on the rise. Not even this time, but a few years back, people have been worried about the emerging economic nationalisms. We discussed that among Jokowi team at the time because I was helping Jokowi in drafting his legal agenda. And Jokowi realized that with this gridlock, with this polarizations of governments, because on one hand, you have an executive run by Jokowi. On the other hand, you have very strong legislative run by Prabowo's camp. It is not going to be easy for anyone, including Jokowi, to be effective. And I think this is the challenge. But I do believe that people, especially the grassroots people, are behind Jokowi's. And I do believe that over time, he'll be able to consolidate his power base, consolidate the support. And I have to add here that the strong support of civil society and free press is really important, and that can be very instrumental in pushing Prabowo's camp, yeah, to retreat, you know. So I'm still optimistic. You know, it's not going to be easy, but I do believe that we have the momentum. We have the momentum.
I just wondered if you'd like to share about the challenges for the judiciary in terms of decentralisation, and in particular with reference to Sharia law in other areas.
Well, it is a good question. Yeah, I think this is a real challenge for the judiciary, you know. But most of the Sharia laws, yeah, are in the forms of regional regulations at Perda, yeah, at the provincial and kabupaten level, not at national level. Of course, you know, there are few at the national level. When you talk about the law on pornography, for instance, that has to do with Sharia. There are elements of fundamentalism within the party systems here. Yeah? I'm not naming the parties, but there are elements of fundamentalisms, radicalizations of Islam, Shariaizations, yeah. And they are the ones who want to introduce Sharia elements in our national law. But I do believe that both the legislatures and the judiciary are not really in favor of that. Yeah. If there are perda or the regional regulation passed, promulgated by the local governments, will it be enforced? I'm not so sure. Yeah. I don't think the Supreme Court will enforce that. Yeah. But what we need to do perhaps is to challenge that through a series of judicial review, either to the Supreme Courts or to the Constitutional Court. That is the way to stop them. And I believe by doing that, we will help the Supreme Courts in domesticating that, you know, attempt, yeah, or spirit, yeah.
Can you speak up as loud as you can? Thank you.
I'm doing my PhD at another business school. I'm a lecturer at the University of Indonesia as well, outside of the U.S. at the moment. I'm looking at corruption in Indonesia for my PhD, and my question for you would be, what change that we could expect to see to the business-government relations under the new era and with regards to corruption especially? Because, you know, a lot of things are going on behind the scenes. Everybody are saying they are pro-governance. They want better corporate governance, for example, from the corporate sector. But we haven't seen that many changes. What could we expect to see more in the future? And then probably just a small question. Could you elaborate more on the cost of reform that you mentioned in your last slide?
Well, let me repeat what Jokowi said during the debate, you know, because he always talked about the need to have e-procurement, yeah, e-tenders, yeah, e-commerce, and others. Now, why he did say that, you know? Because corruption mainly is cash transaction, mainly. People don't do corruption through bank transfers anymore because it will be detected by the anti-money laundering agencies. So in the past, they did transfer, you know, money to the corrupt officials, but not anymore. So by introducing e-commerce, e-transaction, e-procurement, e-tenders, we minimize the face-to-face communications between the buyers and the sellers, between the governments and the contractors. Will it stop corruption? Of course not, yeah? But it will minimize corruption. Now, secondly, the government would introduce a non-cash transaction policy. The central bank has agreed on that already. So later on, you will not have, you know, a big transaction in cash anymore. Gradually, there will be a schedule, you know, a plan, you know, to reduce the amount of cash transaction over time. So I think by introducing non-cash transaction policy, that would also reduce corruption. Now, thirdly, of course, you need a strong legal enforcement. There should be no compromise. And although I should say there are over hundreds of corrupt officials been sent to jail by KPK, yeah, it doesn't stop, you know, corruption. But if you keep on doing that, I think it will have an impact. But I do believe on top of that, no matter what, you need to change the system, make it more open, more transparent, more accountable. Because at the end of the day, no matter how many people sent to jail, it will not stop corruption, as long as you have the opportunity to corrupt, because the incentive to corrupt is there. How many people can be caught by the police or the prosecutors? Not that many, yeah?
I'm a student at the law school and also work at CILIS. Pak Mulya, many of the agencies that you mentioned as having the capacity to strengthen transparency, good governance, combat corruption within Indonesia, at present have a very minimum, if any, presence in the regions in different provinces throughout Indonesia.
Yes.
You mentioned that all of those agencies face very severe budgetary constraints, and obviously setting up offices in remote regions is quite a costly affair. But at the same time, there's a risk that you might have a patchy rule of law in Indonesia where if you strengthen the institutions in Jakarta, remote provinces might be, you know, at a completely different stage in terms of legal development. How will Jokowi tackle the issue of the rule of law, particularly in Indonesia's more remote regions?
Well, KPK has been planning to have offices, you know, in other cities. But of course, you know, the budget constraint is there, yeah? The Judicial Commission has that plan as well, yeah? To set up their chapters in the regions, yeah? Not to mention other agencies. Yeah? But I do believe, you know, they managed to build up their own network. So there's an anti-corruption network built up by either Corruption Eradication Commission, Judicial Commission, and the others. And with the support of the civil society, that would help them, you know, to go after the corrupt official, yeah, to clean up the houses, the judiciary, the executives, yeah. But other than that, I think it is going to be quite unlikely, yeah, for them to, yeah, branch out, you know, to the regions. Now, unless they increase the budget, the state budget, at the moment, I think it is not enough, yeah, if they want to branch out, you know, to set up offices in the regions. Now, I don't know whether the new government be able to do that under this kind of circumstances, you know, it remains to be seen. But yeah, I do hope, you know, they would come to terms. But yeah, it is quite difficult at the moment. It's quite remote.
When do you make them return to university? Thank you, Professor Lubis. Just following up on that, you mentioned that less than 10% of the state budget is spent in this
country.
What would be a reasonable percentage? I'm sorry, I'm ignorant. I have no idea, for example, how much would be spent, say, for example, in Australia, or how much you might anticipate would be a reasonable amount to be spent in the area of constitutional law courts and Supreme Courts. Could you give a
guesstimate
of a percentage?
Well, the budget for education is 20% of the state budget annually. The budget for the health care, I think, is also over 10%. Yeah. The total annual state budget is close to 2,000 trillion rupiah. I don't know how much is that in dollars, you know, it's about 1800 something, you know. But again, you know, 10%, yeah, it's not, you know, sufficient, you know. If you're asking me how much more, you know, I'm thinking of, you know, allocating probably around 15% of the budget, you know, for all these legal agencies combined. Yeah. Now, of course, you know, beyond that, yeah, it won't be possible. Yeah, it won't be possible. But if we manage to have, 5% budget increase, that would. It will be quite significant, you know, to expand their activities or their programs.
Just out of curiosity, is there anybody in the audience who can answer Wendy's question, who knows how much percentage is in the Australian budget, the judicial? Is there anybody here who knows? No, well, it looks like we've all got homework to do on the internet, doesn't it? Okay, next question.
Yes. My name is Camille. I'm actually from the Faculty of Architecture. My question doesn't relate to architecture, I'm asking where in Indonesia do you think, and it doesn't have to be geographically, that the intensity of corruption is most visible or prevalent. I guess I can pass it because in one of your slides, you talked about one of the ways to eradicate it is to have the sphere of corruption culture. And as we know, you know, people who come from different backgrounds and situation have different culture and situation of corruption.
Well, I found Transparency International Indonesian chapters. I'm the founders of the Transparency International, and I chaired that for 8 years. Yeah. During 8 years, we did number of surveys, yeah, together with Transparency International. Now, one of the surveys is called Global Corruption Barometers. In that survey, they name 4 institutions as the most corrupt institutions in Indonesia. One is Parliament, DPR. Number 2 is political parties. Number 3 is judiciary.
Number four is the police. And I think we should add one more, the tax official. Tax and customs. Those are also the place for corruption. So if you really want, you know, fight corruption, go after these four institutions. Yeah. For your information, when I mentioned about 102 corrupt officials, most of them are politicians, member of parliaments. So you'll be surprised to know how much they corrupt, yeah? It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable, yeah? But I think we have to go after them, you know? These are the four most corrupt institutions in the country, yeah? I don't know about, you know, Australia, but Indonesia, certainly there are the four institutions.
Thank you very much for your presentation. My question is, Joe Cowley has had far more experience of regional government than any previous president. Many of the officials and politicians at the FAK has jailed are also from regional governments. Many of the difficulties surrounding investment and anti-business regulations and politics around them are also in the regions. What sorts of plans do you envisage President Jokowi will have in terms of the reform of the region?
Well, aside from, you know, introducing e-government, as he keeps saying, you know, during the campaign, he would like to simplify, yeah, all the permit issuance in the regions. He was talking about setting up one roof policy. Yeah, for him being a former businessman, he sees that as number one priority. Getting permit, getting license, yeah, is something very, very troublesome for businessmen. One of my clients is Indonesian Electric Company. We need more power. Now, there are investors want to invest to build power plant, to build facilities to support the power plant. Yeah. But how long does it take to get the license? Now, if you read all the laws and regulations overlapping one another, conflicting one another, it requires you, you know, 324 days, yeah, to get the license. That's by laws, according to the laws. But in practice, it takes you 3 up to 5 years. So when we discuss this over with Jokowi, how could you have investors coming in to the country if you don't simplify the licensing procedures? Now he said, yes, this is what he will do to strengthen the regional autonomy. So there will be more autonomy to the regions to simplify all this investment regulations, permit requirements, and I think that probably one of agenda or program that is doable, attainable. Yeah. Now, of course, there are others. Yeah, but being a businessman, you know, he is very concerned with that. You know, so I think the investment would like that. He talked with the investors, with business community on these issues. You know. That's among others. Yeah.
Okay, we have time for one question, and it looks like Professor Tim Lindsay is stealing it.
When I introduced you, I spoke about the policy that Jokowi defends the law and justice, and how he has committed to inquiries into the human rights cases, going back to 1966 a whole lot, as well in return to 1998, others as well. Let's assume that the current problems with Prabowo and the red and white borders are resolved. Let's imagine that Jokowi is no longer faced with somebody who has a majority in his own legislature. Even then, do you really think Jokowi will have the political capability of reopening those cases, in particular 66, but all the others as well? Do you think it's really politically possible?
Do you need my honest answer to that?
You can give us the dishonest and then the honest.
Well, I think this is one of the agenda of Jokowi's governments. Because during the debate, he mentioned that. He reiterated that. Yeah, that he would like to resolve past human rights abuses. But the fact of the matter is, he's not alone. He's not by himself running the governments. He's also surrounded by people who will not let him do that. And as long as those people are there, yeah, it would be very unlikely that Jokowi would be able to implement that, yeah. Now, that's why Jokowi keeps saying he needs the support from the civil society. He needs the support from the media. And I think the source, the strength of Jokowi is not the political parties. The strength of Jokowi is not coming from the parliament. The strength of Jokowi comes from the civil society, from the grassroots, from the free press. And if we can mobilize support for Jokowi, he would have more leverage. But when will he have more leverage, that remains to be seen. Probably, I don't know whether you are satisfied with the answer or not.
Now, before I ask Professor Evans out, we're just going to have a short commercial break. Firstly, on your tables there, you will find notices for a book launch and photo exhibition that we're having next week. If by chance you didn't get a notice, you can just go to the CILIS website and download one there. Secondly, we have a very few copies of Pak Mulya's talk tonight, but we would urge you to think about trees and not to take one if you're not going to read it tonight, because in about December, maybe late November, we'll be publishing on our website a copy of the talk. So if you can wait until then, you can download it, but if you have an urgent need to read it tonight, we do have a few copies. I also just want to take this opportunity to thank the CILIS staff. So Catherine Taylor and Vicky, and helping tonight was Sarah Rennie, but particularly I wish to thank Tessa, who as usual has put an enormous amount of effort from flowers to formatting slides to organising food, just about everything that you can see has her artistic taste. And now, so yes. So now I'd like to ask Professor Carol Evans, the Dean of the Melbourne Law School, to propose a toast to Pak Mulya. Thank you, Karen.
Thank you, Helen. And just a few final thank yous from me, of course, also to my colleagues Tim and Helen, who've done a wonderful job in bringing Professor Lubis out, in scheduling every single moment of his time here. So that his visit could have the maximum possible chance to engage with the community here in Melbourne, and who of course have continued through their work and through the work of CILIS to increase the knowledge, understanding between our two countries and their legal systems. I'd also like to thank and acknowledge the University of Melbourne's funding of this visit as part of its ongoing commitment to strengthening and deepening relationships with important intellectual figures throughout Asia. And of course, to thank you tonight for your presence, for your attention, and for a really insightful and thoughtful group of questions. But our main thanks, of course, must go to our speaker, Professor Lubis. In this lecture tonight, we have ranged very far and wide, historically, from the founding of the Constitution to the current day, and indeed, perhaps some predictions of the next couple of years. Looked at the role of e-commerce in reducing corruption, I must say, a new but interesting idea to me, the criminalisation of commercial behaviour, the type of implementation that's going to be necessary in order for President Jokowi to really come to his commitments in terms of human rights and anti-corruption. I think we've been very fortunate to have somebody so knowledgeable and so thoughtful give us his time and develop such a detailed and wide-ranging lecture tonight. And I think the people of Indonesia are very fortunate that the incoming president has had the advice of somebody who has such a clear commitment to the rule of law and who's able to bridge that very difficult divide between really understanding the commercial and business world, but also understanding the interests and the importance of issues like human rights and the needs of ordinary people. Professor Lubis, we're absolutely delighted when you accepted our professorial fellowship last year. It's an honour that this law school does not bestow lightly, only two people from Indonesia have been offered to, but I think we've seen tonight why we thought that you were such a deserving recipient of such honour. Please join with me in thanking tonight's speaker.
Photo op.